Good morning, everybody. We shall start our morning session. I hope you had a nice weekend. It was a little bit humid. Now, during our study here, we are studying polycrystal behavior. So we shall study all aspects of polycrystal plasticity and the major phenomenon which are happening during large plastic deformation of polycrystals. They all should be studied, and then the link should be made between them to make a more complex and more physically sound simulation. So what did we do so far? We were looking at the polycrystal when the grain of the individual grains of the polycrystal, they remain intact, they only deform. We looked at the texture evolution, we looked at hardening also a little bit, how hardening can be taken into account. Now, one thing which is happening during large plastic strain is that grains do not remain grains as they are supposed to be. They do not follow, actually, at large strains, the grain shape changes which they are supposed to do. So there is grain fragmentation, and this is an important phenomenon which should be also studied and then taken into account. So let's see what are the possibilities to simulate that. First, I show some evidences for grain fragmentation. The phenomenon becomes extremely important in large strains, but already at smaller strains. Here we look at an aluminium, commercially pure, which was deformed up to a shear strain of 4. Shear strain of 4. So the initial microstructure consists of equiaxed grains, as you can see here. The grain size is about, this is 100 micrometer, this sign. The grain size about 100 or 50 micrometer. There is a lot of red color here. And this is an EBSD image. So the red color means that there is a strong texture in this material. This is aluminium. It was cut from aluminium sheet. The aluminium was previously, of course, rolled and then heat treated. And that procedure leads usually at so-called cube texture. So the material has cube orientations and then a dispersion around the cube orientations. So initially texture is quite strong. Now, it was deformed by an interesting simple shear testing, which is shown in this small diagram. I hope you can see it. Later we can talk about this testing. It is called high pressure tube twisting. Not high pressure torsion, but tube twisting. This sever plastic deformation technique is coming from my laboratory. We invented it, how to deform tubes to extremely large strains without having material instabilities. It's a version of the so-called high pressure torsion testing. In high pressure torsion, a disc is deformed usually a small disc, diameter only 10 millimeter, or exceptionally 20, and the thickness is about 1 millimeter or less. So a large pressure is applied on the disc on both sides, of course. The pressure is very high, and then the upper or the bottom anvil is rotated with respect to the other. So shear deformation appears, as you can see, somehow like this. But very, very large strains can be obtained because there is no material instability, no sample instability possible. The sample is almost fully constrained. Now, here in a high pressure torsion, HPT, one of the interesting properties is that the strain varies from the center to the edge. It is supposed to be zero in the middle and increases proportionally to the end. So there is a strain gradient. So when we invented the so-called HPTT, high pressure tube twisting, so this means here tube twisting, then our objective was to have one definitive strain to avoid the strain gradient. So we were hoping if we take a thin wall tube and then we'll deform it, then it will be uniform within the tube thickness, because the tube thickness is small with respect to the tube diameter. We were hoping there will be uniform shear strain in it. So here, in this testing, we have the tube, and then the tube is deformed, not like usually the bars are deformed in torsion, but the tube is deformed such that the external part of the tube is shifted with respect to the internal part. So the shear is in this direction, on this plane. I mean in this plane and then tangent direction. So the shear process is 90 degree rotated with respect to the HPT. 90 degree rotated. So it is like that. We put actually inside the tube there is a mandrel, outside there is also a mandrel. The tube is just constrained by pressure, because we apply a high pressure on one mandrel and on the other, and then in this way the pressure is applied only on this surface, and then a large hydrostatic pressure is developing within the tube wall that will push the tube surface inside and also outside to the respective mandrels, so that a very large friction force can be developed, and that friction force rotating the sample, just like here. So this is our invention, the so-called HPTT, and then we studied material civil plastic deformation for already in three theses for different materials and different cases. So if you, let's say, just deform by a shear strain of 4, here usually if the wall thickness is like 1 millimeter wall thickness, then one rotation and the diameter is about 20, samples are larger than in this case, much larger, and they are longer. So then shear strains of about 60 can be achieved in one rotation, which is extremely high strain. Such a large strains, they produce easily grain fragmentation. But already, shear strain of 4, which is only just something like 15 degrees rotation, or 30, produces this kind of microstructure. So here, this plane, the plane like here, is the external plane. And this is how we look at it. You can see the shear strain, of course, will change the axis, rotate the grain axis in the direction of the shear, in that direction. And then one can see that it's about 4 or even more. So if I take that distance and divide with that, yeah, it's about something like 4 or 5 shear strain. Now, the expected grain shape variation would be such that a grain, now here the scale is different, so this is only 5 micrometer. So the total length is about something like 50 micrometer is here a grain, something like that, small grain like this. So we look at actually in a surface which is this dimension here. So one grain would be deforming like this, but obviously we see that inside there's a lot of fragmentation, so the grain does not is not able to keep its integrity. Somehow it is subdivided, and this phenomenon should affect the texture evolution, should affect the hardening, should affect the stress capacity, stress bearing capacity of the material, so strain hardening. Now, how to model such phenomenon? It was about 2010, yeah, or 2009 actually, when we developed during my sabbatical stay in Australia a new theory for modeling this grain fragmentation process in a quantitative manner, so that all phenomenon are included: texture evolution, grain size evolution, disorientation evolutions, and so on. So the idea was that in a polycrystal, if you look at a grain, so this would be one grain of the polycrystal here, then as we already studied and then already did simulations, during large strain the lattice orientation is changing. So what we imagined during those calculations to large strains, that if there is an initial lattice plane within the crystal like this, then it would rotate during plastic strain. So this is the initial state, and this would be its position after deformation. So this leads to the texture evolution, the orientation change of individual crystals, which is different depending on orientation, leads to the so-called texture evolution. And now we have the tools, the understanding, and also the numerical tools, how to model that. But that modeling actually, of course, assumes that this is a kind of uniform process, so that a lattice plane will remain ideally a plane during plastic strain. Initially, when the material is very and it's not deformed, it's like very well prepared, annealed, all stresses relaxed and everything, then it is certainly true that lattice planes are really lattice planes, and they are planes. One can verify that by measuring mapping the interior of the grain by EBSD and then checking what is the orientation spread within the grain. The grain orientation spread, the so-called GOS, and then usually it is a very small value for initial annealed materials within 1 degree. So they are really kind of similar crystals. But can we imagine that when there is large strain that it will still remain a plane? Well, that is not obvious, because the grain is surrounded by other grains, so everywhere there are the neighbors, and we know from polycrystal plasticity that they do not even deform the same way. Self-consistent model permits that they deform differently, they rotate differently. So at the grain boundary, there's an interaction between the grains. Grain boundary regions are not able to deform in the same way as the grain interior. So there's a difference between the two. The grain interior, there is a region which is practically not affected by the grain boundary, and then there is a zone which is affected by the grain boundary. So what can be the effect of for respect to this rotation of the lattice? The effect can be that the lattice rotation slows down in this region. It is also known that near the grain boundary there are more constraints with respect to the other grains, so multiple slip has to happen. Multiple slip leads to lower plastic spins. So then, and inside here, the deformation is more free, so then less number of slip systems are usually active in the middle of the grain. And more number of slip systems are active in the grain boundary region. So this difference leads to differences in the lattice rotation. So the lattice rotation is supposed to be to slow down near the grain boundary. And then, consequently, the lattice plane will not remain straight, but the lattice plane itself will be curved. This is what we call lattice curvature. So if the grain rotates in this way, the lattice rotates in this way, then the lattice curvature should be taking this kind of S shape. That kind of lattice curvatures in deformed materials are seen easily with EBSD. After deformation, you study again the orientations within the grains, the orientation spread, and then it is seen that a lot of difference in orientation, lattice orientation, along a line which is crossing the grain boundary and then approaching the center. Orientation, large orientation differences develop. So assuming this so-called non-uniform lattice rotation or lattice curvature, not really assuming, but taking this into account, we can develop a kind of grain fragmentation mechanism. Well, let me show other, even at small strains. This is experimental evidence. The strain was only 2%. This is titanium. Titanium rolled to only 2% by rolling. And the colors represent the crystal orientation, local orientation, and the dots, they are the middle of the grains. And then you can see that there is a lot of orientation gradient already at 2 degrees, 2% strain. 2% strain, orientation gradients up to 5 degrees easily develop. So let's try to think what would be the consequence of the lattice curvature. So now our simplified model is something like this, that there is a central region in which the lattice plane remains plane, and then in the outside region, the grain boundary region here, the lattice will be approximated with just a simple circle, a part of circle. Well, to maintain this orientation differences within the crystal, actually dislocations are needed. They are called geometrically necessary dislocations. Certainly you heard of them, the so-called GNDs, and then they have to accumulate within the material in order to maintain, to provide this lattice curvature. So these are dislocation arrangements which the dislocations have more or less the same sign. It's not a random Burgers vector distribution, but they have a definitive sign, and they accumulate, and on longer distances, large orientation differences happen. So one can even make a small calculation, assuming the geometry and a given rotation of the slowing down of the lattice plane in the grain boundary region. So instead of this direction here, we can take the lattice like this. One can calculate by approximating the local curvature by an arc. How much is the curvature-induced dislocation density? Initially, we called it CID, which means curvature-induced dislocation density, but they are actually simply GNDs, geometrically necessary dislocations. So one can even, from the curvature, which is here 1 over r, and the Burgers vector, obtain the CID, and after calculating r, which is just geometry here, one can have a formula how much would be the GND density if a factor of slowing down of the lattice rotation is assumed, which is the factor of mu. This is just mathematics. What is important is to have the physical image behind this process. So now, a continuous lattice curvature, which is of course also observed in the material, but it's limited. The continuous lattice curvature is limited to a certain value because it requires a continuous distribution of dislocations, GNDs. So this is the lattice here, lattice plane, curved. For a continuous curvature, we need a continuous distribution, large density of dislocations. Now, but usually dislocations do not like to be homogeneously distributed. They are grouping into groups. So the grouping of these same sign of dislocations produces dislocation walls, and these dislocation walls having the same sign of course represent orientation difference from one side to the other. And in this way the lattice curvature disappears. So so that it will be replaced with two lattices, both of them are straight, and then an orientation difference appears between the two. So this is the mechanics or the mechanism by GNDs which is supposed to work continuously up to large strains when orientation differences will develop within the crystal. These are the so-called subgrains which are formed initially. They are just a couple of degrees orientation differences between them, but deformation will continue and continue, and even these subgrains will subdivide, and then finally the notion of initial grain is replaced with these new subgrains which will begin to rotate according to their own slip system activity because they have different orientation. And if they rotate differently, lattice rotation is different, then orientation differences accumulate and finally large angular grain boundaries appear and the grain fragmentation process is accomplished, meaning that it's a completely new grain structure appears. So that's the grain fragmentation process. There are nice experimental evidences showing the fragmentation. Here again I show you an interesting map in which we're looking at the map of GND density. So what is GND density mapping? Well, here in EBSD we get orientations in every pixel. Well, along one line there are many, many pixels, and then the orientation distance between them requires dislocation density. That is calculated with simple formulas or with more complicated formulas. Here I'm not going into the theory of GND density calculation, but actually it is related, defined by the so-called Nye tensor, which contains different dislocation density components corresponding to different lattice rotations, components of lattice rotations within the material. And then this dislocation density tensor, one can obtain, define a so-called scalar norm quantity from that, which is representing the density of dislocations, GNDs. And that one is plotted here. It goes up to 10 to the 15 per square meter. So that means that on one square meter surface, 10 to the 15 dislocations are supposed to cross. Very, very large dislocation density. And they are plotted with colors, with this color mapping. And at the same time, the original grain boundaries, I mean the grain boundaries which are identified after shear strain of 2. To get shear strain of 2, we were doing ECAP, one pass ECAP. And this is what you obtained. So these are grain boundaries, the red ones. And inside the grains, deformed grains, we see another structure. The GND density is varying, so that they are grouping into kind of walls as the previous image is suggesting, that they are grouping in, making groups. They have orientations, different orientations in different grains, more or less. And like the dislocation cells, GND dislocations, they also grouping. These are two different mechanisms. We make a difference between the so-called statistical dislocations and the so-called GND dislocations. The statistical dislocations, they are necessary to make the strain. that they permit to deform the material. In a given volume, in a given volume of the material, when we calculate the average Burgers vectors of the statistical dislocations, we get zero. It's not the case when we do it for GNDs. When there are strain heterogeneities, then GNDs are needed, and the integration within a volume of the material gives non-zero Burgers vector, meaning a definitive orientation difference. And like statistical dislocations, it is known since the electron microscope was invented, and they looked at metals, they saw that dislocations group into walls and then cells. It is known for a long time, and the same mechanism is happening for the GNDs. The scale is not the same. Initially, the GND density, GND map, cell structure is larger than the dislocation dislocations statistical cell structure. And later, the dislocation cells disappear when the grain size becomes very small. So this mechanism, results of this mechanism of the GND grouping is seen in the material, of course. So now, how to model this? Well, for the modeling, that's the first model of this kind. So we were trying. Its topology is needed. That's obviously sure that topological calculation has to be done, because we are exploring orientation differences within one grain. So we have to divide the grain into small elements, like infinite elements. The simplest geometry looked to be the cube. So we took the grain as a cubic shape, and then divided into each face into three zones. So there's a central part, or let me show here. The central part is within the cube, is not affected by the grain boundaries. But all the other parts, which are at the grain boundary, they are affected. So in them, the lattice rotation is smaller. We apply just one factor in one, let's say 10%, 20%, 30% smaller the lattice rotation. So this is how what is behind this image. Something like when you imagine an initial lattice plane, then at the boundary it is going to be curved, you see. In the center part, straight, the boundary is curved in an S shape. But and the lattice is three-dimensional, so it is also supposed to be curved in the other direction, depending how it is connected to the grain boundaries. It's a three-dimensional plane. So different distortions, rotations will happen at different parts of the crystal near the grain boundaries. The basic equation is this for orientation differences. This is the lattice rotation calculated by crystal plasticity. Let's say we take the Taylor model. That we can calculate how much the lattice wants to rotate in uniform manner. That we have to correct near the grain boundaries. So in each of these regions which are on the side of the cube, we will reduce that amount of rotation with a factor 1 minus mu. Mu is something like 0.1, 0.4 value, meaning that 10-40% lattice rate orientation slowing can happen. Now, of course, when the when a given lattice is impeded by two grain boundaries, then in that region we have to take into account there should be more lattice slowing down, because there are more than one grain boundaries in which, in the corner region, there will be three grain boundaries to slow down the rotation. On this surface there is only one, there is only one, and so on. On the edge there would be two, so it's one, two, or three. With this counting how many grain boundaries are involved to slow down the rotation, we put a factor of number of grain boundaries here. This is how we get the lattice rotation change. Now, dividing into three zones, we get the so-called Rubik cube. You know the Rubik cube. I'm sure that some of you can put it into a solution in 1 minute. Yes? Is there anybody who can do it in 1 minute? That's it's fantastic. I don't know how people can do that. It's very complex to rotate these things. I do the same thing in the computer with polycrystal plasticity. So for me it seems to be simpler, but I am unable to rotate in 1 minute into position. So we take this kind of Rubik cube kind of geometry. It is just looks like a Rubik cube, and the funny part of the story is that Rubik is a Hungarian person. When he invented this, he's a mathematician. I knew him. I was also in Hungary. It was a colleague at the university. And then after he became very, very famous because he invented this funny rotation of his cube. And he's also Hungarian. So now I am using his geometry for the grain fragmentation. But of course it's not just once the fragmentation happens, that means that orientation difference between these cube elements with respect to the center part and also between them becomes more than a critical value for which we took 5 degrees orientation difference. Then that part of the crystal has to be looked at as an independent grain. So we can no longer use the lattice rotation which belongs to its mother original grain. We have to use its own rotation, not the original rotation, and slow that down because it became another grain. So from that moment, this value of the lattice rotation is calculated from its own orientation, and of course initially it's assumed to be plane within the new grain, and the same procedure has to be applied again for that new subgrain. So once one element of this Rubik cube becomes independent grain, then we divide it also into the Rubik cube and apply the same procedure on it, and so on. Once it is happening in the small Rubik cube that one grain becomes independent, usually the corner grains where there are three grain boundaries, triple points, this is where it becomes again independent. So then the same procedure. This is a kind of fractal process. The same process is applied but at different dimension, different level. Automatically. Different levels. In the initial version of the numerical code, we used three levels. So there were three. The smallest cube had a dimension 3 times 3 times 3, 27 smaller than the initial grain. So that permitted to go up to a grain fragmentation which was about maximum 27 times smaller grain, which is a very big grain fragmentation process. But in reality, it can go even further down. The fragmentation process of grain of metals, it can be even 100 times smaller grain. So you start with a 100 micrometer size grain, you can easily go down to 1 micrometer grain size. For alloys, it is even lower. You can go down to 100 nanometer or some cases smaller. There are reports that even 40 nanometer grain sizes are achieved by plastic grain fragmentation in alloys, alloy metals. I even saw a new paper not long ago in which it is reported that complete loss of lattice structure can be achieved, so this kind of bulk metallic glasses can be even obtained by severe plastic deformation, bulk metallic glasses. Anyway, so let's see if we put this into a computer code, which is of course a little bit complex. So I have the versions for 3 levels or 4 levels. Then what results we can obtain? This is because the model is topological, but it's not a finite element model. But topological, many features we can derive from it. Of course, the texture evolution can be obtained, because if you have orientations in each of these small cubes, you know, technically, it's obvious that technically the procedure would be that we predefine all the small boxes in the very initial state. So if there are 3 levels, it means 27 times 27 times 27, which is, I don't know how many grains, 20,000, about 20,000 small grains, yeah, will be, 20,000 small boxes will be within one cube, one grain. And then we put initially into each of them the same orientation. And then looking at by calculation how lattice orientation differences develop because we force slightly slower rotation near the grain boundary regions, original grain boundary regions. And then this is how the calculation is going. And finally, at the end, we have a many different orientations, and then each box can have different orientation. We can plot the texture, of course, just large grain number we have, very large. Already one grain can subdivide into 20,000. So if we take 100 grain or more, in millions of grains are actually potentially will appear in the simulation. So we can have this topological effect. We have to finally, when we deform it, we have to identify at the end the grains, because different points deform differently. So at the end or during the simulation, we have to find a way to keep track what volume, what entity is still within 5 degree orientation, which is one grain. So a kind of virtual EBSD has to be done in 3D on this grain at the end to get its grain size, to get its even disorientation distribution. It's like pixels here, but in 3D. Of course, we can cut in 2D also. And then orientation differences between neighboring pixels can be plotted. when grains are identified, then between neighboring grains also can be done. So we have a lot of microstructure information which comes out from the modeling. Of course, grain size, average grain size we get disorientation distribution, texture evolution, and hardening can be also implemented, which was also done. So now, for the code, if you are interested to do calculations with grain fragmentation in silver plastic deformation, the code I made user-friendly, and it is available on an internet site. And at this moment, my young colleagues in Metz, they added to their new kind of JTEX software, which will be called differently. They call it ATEX or ATEX, and then in that code, which is general, you know, kind of how should we call it, crystal plasticity code. So there is possibility to do calculation with the viscoplastic model. It is already possible. The version you had contains polycrystal viscoplastic code, the METS code, with which you can do very easily simulations and immediately plot it with the same software. So the grain fragmentation code will be soon also within that code, and then one can use it quite easily. It should be used because it is very rich and produces so much microstructure features that it's very interesting. And it was never applied, for example, for hexagonal materials, but the code is able to do, of course, also the hexagonal. Hexagonal is a little bit more complicated once there is a twinning in it, because twinning has to be dealt with a special manner. But for glide, only dislocation glide, it is already very good. So here there is an application. We will look at different aspects of the results. Look at the texture evolution. And first, ECAP was done on copper, and then the new parameter was quite large, 0.5 here. 500 initial grains were taken, which represents 6 million small cubes total. So like this is a simulation with 6 million grains, but it's running on a laptop, no problem. Here there are three textures. There is the measured one, measured texture for 111 pole figure in copper. This is how the texture looks like after one pass, and this is how it looks like in a second pass for root BC. You see, this is centrosymmetric because simple shear applies for one pass, but this is not centrosymmetric because the symmetry is lost if we do root BC. This is the texture we obtain. Now, this is the simulated texture with the grain refinement code here. So this should be compared with that one, and this has to be compared with that one. The main features are reproduced. With the Taylor model, this is what we obtain. I should use the self-consistent model, but the code is already so complex that the first version is using the Taylor approach, which is simpler. Now, what is the effect of grain refinement? It's easy, just put mu equal to zero and check what would be the difference. What is new, what grain refinement will bring into the texture? For this material, which is initially more or less random, and we apply shear deformation, this would be the result if we switch off grain fragmentation. So the difference between these two and these two shows the effect of grain fragmentation on texture evolution. I hope you see it quite well. And you would say, but there is not much difference. Right? Not much. That looks almost the same. These also look almost the same. So then, what's the business here? But this is exactly a good business. Because if grain fragmentation, when we take it into account, would produce very different textures, then because this is already in good agreement with the experiment, you know, I mean this one, with the experiment, then all previous simulation work would be wrong, which were done for large trains. And then they were good. We got already good results. So actually the effect on the texture is not very much. It's not supposed to. Even if new, slightly different orientations appear, it doesn't mean that we will get very different texture, because the strain that we apply on the material remains the same. So the ideal orientations are the same. And small orientation differences, we can look at in orientation space, we will not produce new ideal orientations. If we are in orientation space, islet space, here is an ideal orientation, ideal. Well, orientations which are far, they rotate into the ideal one, yeah? So now if during their rotation they will be fragmented, means that different orientations appear, well, they will still look for the same ideal orientation. So they are rotating a quite similar manner into the texture. So grain fragmentation is not supposed to make much differences in the texture evolution. Unless there is a specific initial texture in the material. Here it was more or less random. And this is a good news. Because then we can say previous simulations which were done by all these good scientists making good simulations, and they would not be true. That's not possible. Now, but grain size can be obtained, of course. For each grain we get different fragmentations. The initial grain size in this simulation was 26 micrometer. So this is why it goes down to about 1 average grain size in the simulated one, you see. But there are other larger grains which do not fragment much. I mean, they do, because we used 500 grain orientations with a log normal distribution. So there were small grains and also large grains. The average was 26 micrometer. So this is a simulated one, and here you can see the measured one after one or two passes, I don't know here. And you can see that this is a frequency density distribution, and that even the intensity is quite agrees, and the average grain size is also agreeing. So we get not only average grain size simulation, but also the whole distribution, which looks to be similar. Now, another interesting feature, of course, is that we can obtain the misorientation distribution. Sometimes you can see this disorientation. Actually, the right word to use is disorientation between grains. So here, simple shear was applied. During the simple shear, our initial cubic shape of grain gets into this kind of shape. Here is one grain, how one grain is fragmenting. So by applying this shear strain, which is about 4, here, we get this kind of orientation image by the simulation. So this is EBSD done numerically on the simulation. The experimental image of the material is something like this, and one can see that it has very similar features, especially the sizes of the different regions. They look to be similar. Now, one can plot, of course, the disorientation distribution by the simulation, it's here, and also here by the measurement, and one can see very different features. This is the so-called random Mackenzie distribution, and then this is the simulated one, including neighbors across grain boundaries. What does it mean? The EBSD, this numerical EBSD, can be done grain by grain, and then we have to imagine that they are, of course, there are orientation differences from here to the next grain. So on this plane, on all these planes, we have to take into account orientation differences with the other neighbors. So that's an interesting feature, which is also reproduced quite well in the simulation. Now, what would you not probably expect is that even the disorientation axis distribution can be calculated and then reproduced by this kind of modeling. This is not the angle, but the orientation of the rotation axis between two neighboring grains. These are not pixels, these are grains, and they have neighbor orientations, and then the misorientation axis between them can be plotted in a pole figure. So, and then we get a distribution. This feature is built into EBSD software, so you can also plot it from experiments. The disorientation axis distribution. So experimental observations showed that for this ECAP, where this is the shear process in this direction, the TD axis is preferred for the orientation difference. For different angles, disorientation angles, 2 to 5 degrees, this is the distribution, and 5 to 63 degrees, the distribution is still similar, but we have other spots. Now the simulation work, here I plot only grain by grain, so there are dots, but it reproduces that the center, this is the main disorientation axis during the grain fragmentation process. It's totally unexpected to get such feature in agreement. And then finally here, I present a case where we studied, so this is the very first image we looked at, HPTT of aluminium, shear strain is 4. So the initial material was a cubic texture, unfortunately it is not shown, cube texture, and after shear strain of 4 with this technique, we get this texture in 1-1-1 pole figure. So the cube orientation, which was initially here, rotated about 45, or perhaps more, rotated, and some new components also developed. Now, if you do only simple self-consistent simulation, then the cube texture under simple shear with viscoplastic VPSC model will produce this kind of texture. It's not very satisfactory as texture. Let me look at it. These peaks and these are okay. They are there. But nothing is produced here, and then there this kind of fiber is not seen. So this is disappointing. Now, If we now apply our model, it's only Taylor, but we use the grain fragmentation. And this is the texture we obtain. Compare this with the experiment. You see that we have all the components which are needed. Also the fiber is reproduced. Now if we switch off, interestingly here the Taylor model for this cube material is working better than the self-consistent model. This is a particular case because the initial texture is very strong, and the Taylor model somehow for this large strain without grain refinement produces this texture. Well, for the fiber here this is quite okay. Only there are problems that these components on the edges, which are reproduced by the major ones with self-consistent model, they are not produced with the Taylor model. So here the surprise is that grain fragmentation brings a very good simulation, the best simulation with respect to the other models. But these models, of course, they are unable to reproduce, for example, this. This is the disorientation distribution between neighbor grains and the experimental distribution and the simulated one, they are practically coinciding. So the model is very, very rich in terms of output. As it is expected from polycrystal models, you don't know too much, you don't put too much into, but there's a lot of things which are coming out. Well, I think that for the continuation, we will stop at this moment, and then after the break, we look at some further interesting effects of this grain fragmentation mechanism. Thank you. We shall continue our thinking study on the grain refinement process and what effects are expected and can happen due to grain fragmentation. For the texture, we focus on texture usually, because this is a course for texture oriented. But now, as we cannot neglect, you know, the grain size, we cannot neglect disorientation distributions, many features which are in the microstructure, we have to integrate into our modeling, or we have to use the modeling in order to explain things that we see in the microstructure. So one effect what we are going to look now into is there any effect of the strain path, the strain mode, what we apply on the material to get grain fragmentation. So here is a study in which ECAP was compared to rolling. The same equivalent von Mises strains were looked at. The experimental grain sizes after one ECAP. One ECAP, the experimental grain size in copper is about 1 micrometer grain size if you start with about 25. If you do a second pass, it decreases, but much less. The rate of decrease is much less. That's the second experimental point for ECAP, which is, I think, about 0.8 micrometer experimentally. Now we can look at the same material, same initial grain size, but do other deformation mode, like rolling. So this is what we get in that case. At the same strain, when we do rolling, we get about 2.4 micrometer grain size. And when we further roll, up to strains of 2.2 or 2.1, then the grain size is more than 1 micrometer. Systematically, the grain sizes are larger in rolling. Especially for the smaller strain, the difference is more than double. So these are the experimental points here. And we can think why it is happening, what is the reason for these differences. So the grain fragmentation model was applied for ECAP and also for rolling. The difference is just you change the initial velocity gradient and you go to the same strains. So it's the simulation itself is not complicated. And you could do similar simulation work, because I will provide you the link to the code. It's a similar kind of code as the VPSC, but with the feature of grain fragmentation. It has one single tuning parameter in it. So for ECAP, the deformation mode is a simple shear on the intersection plane of the two channels. So if axis 1 here and axis 2 there, and the velocity gradient will be of this shape. So we have 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, 0, 0. For ECAP, and for rolling, we will roll on plane 2, and then ECAP for velocity gradient for rolling is going to be then minus 1 on plane 2 and 1 in direction 1, plane strain rolling. So this was the velocity gradient applied. What is the difference between the two? Actually, the difference between the two explains the effect. It was detailed, this work in this publication here. So what is the difference? Actually, the difference is in the non-diagonal components. These are the same, 1 minus 1, but here there is minus 1, here is 0, 1 is 0. This thing here in a cup actually is a rigid body rotation. When it is anti-symmetric, it means rigid body rotation, which is imposed on the material. This rigid body rotation is not imposed here. It's not imposed. It is zero in rolling, macroscopic rigid body rotation. Now, if I recall now the equation we developed for lattice rotation, the lattice rotation rate is the difference between this beta dot, which is a beta dot here, this rigid body rotation, and the plastic spin. Yeah, this is the plastic spin. This is the rigid body spin. Rigid body spin. And this is the lattice spin. Lattice orientation. Variation. So it's obvious when we have here a big value, then omega dot will be affected. If it is there, we already were discussing it for the simple shear case and then comparison to rolling, but the consequence will be that the plastic spin is in ideal orientations is very much affected. In case of simple shear, we require a large plastic spin and in rolling requires small. The resultant effect is that the presence of rigid body spin in general leads to, so when there is beta dot, then the result will be that omega dot will be increasing, the overall omega dot. Grains rotate faster. Of course, when they arrive to the other orientations, they stop in both cases, in ECAP and also in rolling. In the other orientations, they stop. But the other orientations, which are not ideal, they are rotating. And because we have the additional rotation, rigid body spin, in simple shear, we have more rotations. So actually, for ECAP, the lattice rotation is larger for those grains which are not in ideal positions. If lattice rotation is more, then lattice curvature develops faster. And this is an effect which immediately leads to faster grain fragmentation. So I repeat, for ECAP, larger lattice rotations happen, and this is why the fragmentation process is more effective. In general, it is a general thing that shear deformations where rigid body spins are involved lead to higher lattice spins, consequently more effective grain fragmentation. So if you look at the different severe plastic deformation processes, we notice that indeed almost all of them, they are simple shear. ECAP, simple shear. Rolling is not considered to be an SPD process, but actually there is ARB, accumulated roll bonding. I don't know if you know the process, accumulated roll bonding. Which is rolling. And then very effective grain refinement can be obtained, but the principles are different. So that there is process in which is SPD process, severe plastic deformation process, but not based on simple shear. But there is ECAP, and there is, let me see, ECAP, yeah, HPT, high pressure torsion. Probably HPT is the most practiced deformation technique at present time. Well, HPTT, which we are using, is a variant of HPT. And not many people are doing for the moment. Also based on simple shear. So simple shear, simple shear, simple shear. And there are more processes which are known. ARB is also very, very popular. So the explanation of higher fragmentation is within our crystal plasticity knowledge. And responsible for this is the so-called rigid body rotation, which happens in simple shear processes. So this was nicely explained. That's the simulated grain size, the function of strain coming out from the model. Then we use this velocity gradient. And this is the rolling case. Using the same parameters, no change at all, just changing the velocity gradient. Very powerful. Now we will go into another effect which needs explanation. So grain fragmentation is physical phenomenon, very evident, very useful. You know that smaller grain size because of the hull patch relation leads to higher flow stress of the material, so the material becomes stronger. So naturally the material becomes stronger by plastic deformation. Now, another effect which was long time and not well understood and modeled is the so-called reversal textures. What is reversal texture? Strain reversal texture. Well, what we expect that if we deform the material in this way and then we come back to the original, then grain shape is recovered and then grain orientations are inverted, so grain shapes should come back and also the texture should come back to the initial one. That's the reversal philosophy. So let's look at the grain shape first. This experiment on ECAP was done for one pass and two passes in the so-called root C. Root C is such root in ECAP that in every second pass the strain is inverted, opposite. So one can say that first ECAP is like this, and because of the rotations we apply after the first pass, we put it back, with respect to the material, it will be inverted. So opposite shear happens in the material. The consequence on the microstructure is this here. Initial material looks like that, with some twins in it, annealing twins. And then after one pass, we get it elongated because shear happened on the 45 degree plane, like this. That is the shear, and the grain shape is turning in the direction of shear. It does not agree with the direction of the grains, will not be the same as the shear plane. It is progressive, you need very large strain to arrive into that. So this is different. This is the shear plane here, and these are the axes of the grains. Shear strain of 2 applied was applied, meaning that this is 1, then this here is 2. So then the inclination belongs to the shear strain of 2, but the shear plane is here. Okay, it's obvious, we shear, then the grains become elongated. Now, let's apply opposite shear. So now we are going to shear in the second pass on this plane, but opposite. This is what we obtain. This is the second pass. We can see that no more elongated grains. They become more or less similar shapes as the initial grain shapes. There are some elongated ones, but they were probably annealing twins. They are recovered in shape. And it's not exactly the same place in the microstructure, of course. It's impossible to take such comparison. It's another place in the microstructure, but very much similar to the initial one, except that there are some irregularities in orientations inside the grains. But the shapes are recovered. So the shapes are recovered, then the orientations should be also recovered. That's what philosophy would suggest. Well, let's see the measurements. Is it recovered or not? So here there are two measurements. It's very conclusive because we also, this comes from a work of Irene Beyerlein in 2006. So when they studied on copper, this is the texture after first pass. They obtained nice shear texture, as it expected. And we can even simulate it. you can put this velocity gradient in your VPSC code, you will get the ECAP textures. You will get such kind of texture. And then you will apply opposite shear in the experiment, second pass. This is the texture what we obtain. This is not random. Initially it was kind of random texture. This was the initial texture in our case. In our case. We did also experiments. First pass, this is the texture we obtained. This is 2011. Very similar to the measurements of the Los Alamos group. We can recognize the ideal orientations of the textures. So there are these fibers here, the A fiber, the B fiber appearing three times. They are all there. The A fiber is only strong in this part. And then second pass, strain reversal. This is the texture we obtain. Again, very similar to that measurement. A little bit better quality. And then we can still recognize that the same ideal components, they are still there. The texture is somewhat a little bit less strong, but obviously didn't go back into this initial one. Here we have the initial texture as well. They didn't publish. We have it. So this was initial texture, more or less random. It doesn't go back. Even after inverting the shear, grain shape goes back, texture does not. So there were quite much thinking about that and modeling efforts to find the reason for this. What kind of explanations can happen? Were taken. Here I cite a number of papers in which all these different things were tried. In all of these papers, Ian Bayerline is co-author, as you can see, so she was the driving force for this study. So they tried many things. Let's take into account grain-to-grain interactions. You know that in the viscoplastic code there is this co-rotational scheme which is available. And I showed you already a simulation result. And you can try also yourself. Just put one into that option in the input file. And you will have co-rotations of grains. The co-rotation is artificial. If you have 1,000 initial grains, then one grain will be randomly assigned as neighbor to the other. Although there is no topology in the calculation, but we say that they are neighbors. We just assign them initially, in the initial state. And then the code, when treats one by one each grain, then we'll get lattice rotations. If the lattice rotations for these two pairs is different, then it will take the average and forcing that average value for both of them. That means that they are in lattice rotation, they co-rotate. This is an idea. Many ideas can be put into a modeling and tried, but unfortunately was not able to reproduce the strain reversal textures. Now, isotropic hardening. Whether hardening is playing a role in the strain reversal textures, well, it was found to be that no effect at all. It will still, in the modeling, what we find, if we try to put this into the self-consistent model, first pass, and then we do the second pass with opposite L, the texture will go back to the initial one. No strain reversal texture. You put co-rotational scheme, it goes back. Isotropic hardening also. Now, but when you do latent hardening, as I explained with this hardening matrix, you put strong latent hardening, then there is effect. There is some texture which remains, but the texture seems to be very weak, so cannot explain the magnitude of what we observed. Now, heterogeneous strain was also tried when strain was varied, you know, like deformation bands happened during strain, strain localizations, deformation bending, and that was also tried. Could not explain. Some small effects could be observed, but not sufficient. One was successful, the so-called imperfect strain reversal. When the strain part does not agree well in the opposite. Because ECAP, well, ECAP is actually here, we use simply shear. But in reality, deformation mode a little bit more complex. For simple shear, a material point should here change rapidly its moving direction. Yeah. Immediately in one plane. Well, that is unlikely happening. What is happening that the material line is rounded as the material element is moving. So if it is rounded, then the simple shear hypothesis is just an approximation. So that can be done with finite elements, for example. Finite element calculations produce these rounded flow lines. And you can also do a second finite element calculation with root C. And then effects will be there. And then the strain reversal textures can be seen. So those simulations produced already some explanation. But those simulations did not take into account the grain fragmentation, which is happening during the process. So the result is reproduced, but perhaps not for the full reason. The other reason can be, and this is what I am showing now to you, a grain refinement mechanism. If we take into account that, whether we can reproduce the textures or not. This I will skip. We go into the textures. So here are the results. For one pass, when we use a Taylor modeling, VPSC modeling, or the grain refinement modeling. I just call my grain refinement model as grain refinement model. For one pass, there is not much difference you see between Taylor and VPSC. I mean, Taylor is one case of VPSC, but here the tangent model was used, and it's producing better textures with respect to experiments. And the grain refinement model is also producing something which is in between these two, Taylor and VPSC. And this is the experiment, so the agreement of all these three top figures is pretty good with the experiment. They are okay. Two simulations were done here. Because we noticed some effect of the strain increment. This is in shear, we applied 0.005 increment of shear strain in one increment. Then more increments had to be done to reach the shear strain of equal to 2, which is how much? You divide 2 with this one. Large number of increments reaching the same strain, this is the texture which was obtained. So between the top and bottom, only the strain increment is different. The textures are nearly the same. Here, only 10 steps is needed to reach the shear strain of 2, and the texture is good. So the way to do such as small steps, when with big steps it is also good. But we looked at it and found, okay, you can apply quite big steps. Textures will be good. Now we do the opposite. We do the second pass. So we invert the strain and we repeat these calculations for opposite strain. So now, actually, I have several. Increment 0.2, only 10 steps. 0.05, 40 steps. And then so on. Here, this is the largest number of steps. Just to see that for the second pass, it is also true that we can apply large increments, or we have to use small ones. So here is for a large increment, Taylor model, VPSC model, grain refinement model. For the second pass. For the second pass, yes. It's only the second pass what we look at here. Here is the experiment. Initial texture is here. After two passes, the shear texture is there. So now, comparing this with these three, then we say, oh, wait a minute, Taylor is reproducing already the two-pass experimental texture. The VPSC also, grain refinement also, all three models. They are reproducing the experiment. But I only did 10 steps. My step was 0.2. And it is not sure that large increment is really fine. For the initial first ECAP, it seemed to be fine. Now we want to go back. And then we have to examine that this is risky to take large increment, because this is not applicable. So we have to reduce. So we reduce progressively the steps. Here this is really small steps. Yeah. This is the right calculation. There is no risk. This we might be making a big mistake. Actually we do. If you see the texture, for large steps, apparently the model reproduces the effect, but when you do it right, you use small steps, then it does not. As you can see, it goes back to the initial texture, precisely. So when you do the simulation right, you get initial texture with the Taylor model. When you do the same with the VPSC, so too large step, let's do it right, this is the right one with very small step, then we get again the initial texture. So let's do it now with the grain refinement model. This is not right, too much step, too large step. Okay, so let's decrease it, decrease, and the third price comes that is still producing about the same texture. So the and reproduces quite well the experimental texture. So it means that the only modeling among these three is the grain refinement model. And even if you do it wrong with two big steps, then of course it is working. But this kind of simulation should be never done. One message from this analysis is that when you do polycrystal plasticity modeling, even for proportional strain path, you have to take small steps. What is ideal is about 0.01. That's already a little bit too big. Just 1% of strain. So you need a lot of increments. If you don't do that, then as you can see from these two examples, your result might be actually wrong. This is in agreement with the experiment, but physically wrong, because large increments cannot be justified. So this was the result of the analysis. We were quite much surprised on that. You're analyzing how much grain fragmentation happened and what were the within one grain in the modeling, what were the differences between the final orientations and the initial orientations. So here we examine the misorientation between the initial and final orientations. Of course, because we think it should go back, you know. So in the initial one pass and two pass orientations, we believe that should go back to this one. So we can compare the initial and final one, to what extent it goes really back in the modeling. If it goes back perfectly, the orientation difference between initial and final state is zero. So this is the orientation difference which is plotted here in histograms for the Taylor, VPSC, and the grain refinement modeling. The Taylor model went back within 1 degree. So each orientation of the polycrystal within 1 degree went back. The difference of this small difference was probably due to the hardening, which was implemented in the simulation, and it was self and latent hardening. So latent hardening was already shown that makes some differences, small. Of course, it could not explain the textures. It goes back within 1 degree, each crystal. The VPSC model has more variations, but it is like within 2 degrees, it also goes back. And then when we look at the grain fragmentation model, then the result is very much surprising, because the differences between initial and final positions go up to 60 degrees. The whole region of disorientations which are possible for cubic crystals. That the maximum orientation difference is about 62 degrees, which is the end of the so-called Mackenzie curve here. And you see that one grain, actually because it splits into a lot of other grains, so we compare each of the new small grain with the initial one, then we get differences up to 60 degrees. So the effect of grain fragmentation is enormous on this, and this is also seen here, that the maximum disorientation between the initial and final position is approaching the 62 degrees. But here we examine that as a function of the strain increment, a shear strain increment. This is done for the Taylor model is this one. This is the self-consistent, and this is the grain refinement model. As a function of the shear strain increment now. So when we are doing large increment here, then all models, they give large differences and apparently explain the textures. But all these simulations which are here with high increment are wrong. You have to use small increments, like 0.01 or less. This is what the smallest we applied. And then you see that the Taylor and self-consistent model, of course, is doing this, while the maximum orientation difference, 62 degrees, can happen in the grain refinement modeling. Well, this is impressive, but why it is so? Why the grain fragmentation is producing such big differences for the opposite strain path? For the initial, going there, it's like I go to another city. Okay, I go there. Each model arrives there, no problem. But coming back, not all the models can find the way back to the right place. Well, we have to look for this explanation, and in the rotation field around ideal orientations. In the first pass, we get a texture. So we get many orientations near the ideal components. Here is an ideal component, let's say the C component of simple shear textures. So orientations are coming in. These are the rotation vectors in this way, not the opposite. This is the starting point, this is the end point. So orientations are moving in into the C. If we are far from the orientation, then during large strain, the grain will find it and arrives near to the C component. Perhaps not exactly, to reach exactly the orientation needs more strain, but somewhere nearby, arriving. And now, going back, how does it happen? Well, here there is a very convergent rotation field. A small mistake here in the direction can lead to large differences. So we are not admitted to make mistakes here. The smallest orientation difference will bring us totally different place. And that's what happens if we do large increments in strain, we make a mistake. And if you do small increments, then the mistake is reduced. So actually, it's like I can make a more convincing parallel. It's like when you are a tourist, and you know you are on your car and you want to go to the center of the city. It's flashed, you know, the flashes are there. City center, just follow the flash with your car. You arrive there, you are there. But after, it's no more indicated from which direction you were coming from. So you are there, looking around, and trying to go out. You might not go on the same way, and then you end up in a completely different direction. That's a mistake what you do in the inverse strain path. So inverting the strain path, it's very, very important to do it very precisely. And my only conclusion here is that the grain refinement model gives a precise, physically well established response for the strain reversal deformation textures. Oh no, this one I'm not going to go into this today, probably. Grain boundary sliding and other things. We will do it later in the following. For the moment, I'm going to stop here with the theoretical development and simulations, effects of grain refinement. I accept any question if you have now. Previous slide. Here? That one. One more. This one?
Yes. After two passes, the structure is, you are saying that the grain structure is almost
reconstructed. Yes. Yeah, this is precisely the case that grain fragmentation happened. So, in this phase and also in the second part. And although the grain boundaries, they go back into their initial configurations, but inside the grains, there is lots of new boundaries There are new boundaries. It is fragmented. Well, dislocation density, you don't see dislocations on this image. The resolution does not permit you. This is something like 100 micrometer here, I believe. Yes, 100 micrometer, that size. You cannot see dislocations. But of course, you know that large strain involves a lot of dislocations. Indeed, by inverting the deformation, the dislocations will not be inverted fully. And some of them will be, those who are mobile. There is a mobile dislocation density within the material. If you invert the strain, they are most probably also gliding opposite direction. But there is a large population of fixed dislocations, they don't. And then, during the opposite strain, the new dislocation density will increase, further increase. So there is strain hardening in the second pass. But dislocations, they just accumulate. In the very initial stage, perhaps there is some decrease of some dislocation density will annihilate. But later, they will increase.
But yes? There must be some effect from the back stress also.
Yes, the back stresses can make the effect initially. Those are disappearing quite fast because back stress is elastic stress. And back stresses are related to the yield surface. If I use the yield surface representation of a single crystal, yield surface, stress space, then what are the back stresses? It's like if we are, let's say, here, and this was the deformation we applied, because of the elastic component of the strain, elastic component is parallel to the yield surface, elastic component. If we release the stress or we make it opposite, then this is going to move. So a stress state moves from here to here, for example, and those are the elastic back stresses which will remain in the material. We discussed it on the cyclic deformation, that when you completely unload, then there are some stress states within the material. So those are back stresses or residual stresses. Of course, when you reload the material, they will have an effect. But the effect is quite limited in terms of strain range because, let's say we are here, that's a back stress. And we load the material. Okay, we arrive there. We load it. That is the elastic part. We arrive to that vertex, and then we continue deforming. But the activity of these slip systems will rotate the whole yield surface. The crystal is rotating quite much. So then the effect of this here, you know, if it was here or it was there, at the end will not be much. The stress strain, one can see an effect on the stress strain curve. Let's say this is a stress and strain. So in the first pass, we arrive to somewhere here. Okay, we download. And then we load in the opposite direction. Yeah. Opposite, important. Now I should go down, but I go up. So it's a plus or minus. Go up, then these back stresses and residual stresses will make a Bauschinger effect first. A Bauschinger effect, yeah. But then it is observed that usually it is reaching about the same curve. So the effect is limited to a small, usually small strain. There can be also effects like this, that there is some annihilation. So this would be the expected rate, but annihilation of dislocations happen because of the inverted strain path. and then these residual stresses, they make disappear a lot of dislocations. They help the annihilation of dislocations. They never usually increase. So these effects are small, they happen at the initial stage. At the final stage, for textures, they will be not relevant. Any other question? Yes. They were a cubic shape. Yes, but the shape itself doesn't matter because I used the Taylor model. The Taylor model was used, so grain shape effects were not relevant. It would be important if I used the viscoplastic model. So if there's a grain boundary like this or it is curved, for the Taylor model, it doesn't make difference because it's a homogeneous strain with no effect of grain shape.